investigate the development of artificial intelligence over the last 30 years. The Design and Technology Program at Parsons presents Cloud Salon, a Zoom webinar series that invites artists, designers, technologists, and industry professionals to present projects and engage in direct conversation with participants. And so the talk will begin with a 20-minute presentation by Tomiko, followed by a 40-minute conversation with attendees and moderated by yourself truly, as well as other faculty here at the New School. So with that, I would like to invite Tomiko to go ahead and take over the screen. And thank you all for coming to join us.
Thank you, Catherine, for the introduction. I'll see if we can go right into share. And I'll go full screen. And 20 minutes is a little bit short, so I'm going to kind of talk fast and break things. So just to start out, I started out as a product design mechanical engineer. And what I call my last job as a product design engineer, but also my first artwork, was the Connection Machine, as Catherine mentioned. It came out of the AI lab. Danny Hillis had been doing his doctoral thesis designing this machine under Marvin Minsky at the MIT AI lab, started thinking machines. And the idea behind this machine was to, instead of doing a supercomputer with one or maybe two very powerful processors, to have a structure more like the human brain with over 64,000 very simple processors connected together in a 12D internal network. My job, we were pretty young at the time. Danny and I are about the same age. We were 25, 26 at the time. Lots of engineers were younger. So the way that we got this richly connected network of processors was using the idea of Nobel physicist Richard Feynman to connect them together in a 12D Boolean N cube. And I had to wire this stupid thing. So I had to know exactly where every single wire went, and talked with Richard, where he's describing me how the structure goes and replicates itself over many dimensions. That's about an hour's talk in itself. So I'll just say, here's what I came up with in as depiction of the 12 dimensional cube, where I could then say exactly where every trace, every cable had to go in the machine. When it came time to actually build the form of the machine, I realized that the t-shirt that I had designed together with Danny was actually the best description of how the machine actually functioned. So I had drawn a hardware cube of cubes that was a fixed structure, but with these software pom-poms, these software connections that could connect with each other regardless of the hardware structure. And of course, in the late 1990s, this was after Richard had already died of cancer, and after the company Thinking Machines had long gone bankrupt, we were delighted to have my t-shirt resurrected as part of Apple's Think Different campaign, with Richard wearing the t-shirt as he so often did in actually many of his videos. So this is really what the machine looked like. The hardware structure expressed in this black cube of cubes, but with the doors transparent. The LED status lights that are usually right next to each processor chip were moved to the edge so that you could program it to do whatever you wanted. But my concept was that if you're using the processors on that chip, its light should be on, and therefore the machine would talk to us, would be able to show us what it was thinking, how it was thinking as it calculated a problem. And I was, you can imagine my delight when 30 years after the machine launched, by dint of the fact that I had collected all the information I could and done extensive interviews with people who, like Danny and the other engineers who came up with the design, that I was able to convince the Museum of Modern Art to take one of the machines into its collection and put in the effort to make a hardware simulation of the lights. And my ace in the hole was that a friend of mine, Joanna Hoffman, had been working with Stephen, Steve Jobs, at the point when he started his next company. And Joanna told me years later, he said, bring me the designer of the connection machine. I want them to do my new products. And Joanna said, sorry, Tamiko's gone to Europe to become an art student and she doesn't have an email and I can't find her. But that, of course, was what that little piece of information was what MoMA New York needed to bring it into the collection 30 years later. So never give up hope and document your projects. So I first got involved with virtual reality in the 1990s. I ended up in San Francisco after studying art in Munich. And that was a time I didn't realize that it was a couple years earlier that the Silicon Graphics company made these big multi-$100,000 workstations to do real-time interactive 3D virtual reality. But they had come up with the OpenGL standard that allowed this sort of virtual reality to be done on high-end PCs. Steven Spielberg, the filmmaker, was chair of the Starbuck Foundation, which used technology to try and improve the quality of life of seriously ill children. He asked Worlds Incorporated if they could build a virtual world for the children, and I was hired by Worlds Incorporated to be the producer and creative director of that project, actually a lot on the basis of my design for the connection machine, because back in the mid 90s, there were very few people who had a lot of experience both with technology and with art and design. So when you say virtual reality, you think of the helmets, but it was really clear these kids are sick anyway. They don't need to be nauseous from wearing these heavy helmets. They don't need to be connected to the machines. They have to do a dialysis or whatnot. They're connected enough to machines in their normal life as a sick child. So it ran just on monitors with keyboard and mouse. And this is actually the same technology, the same sort of technology that developed into the 3D computer games, the massively multiplayer online games, et cetera, all running on monitors instead of in glasses. So we had five hospitals nationwide, children's hospitals hooked up, but the technology was still extremely unstable. And at some point, the child life specialist said, you know, we want to focus more on the kids and less on having to boot the computers when they get disappointed that, you know, it's down and they can't run off and run around in these virtual worlds and look for E.T., who is, of course, Steven Spielberg's avatar. But this was the first online 3D virtual avatar world for children. With that experience behind me as a manager, I decided I wanted to incorporate this technology into my own art practice. So together with Zara Hushmand, who was also a VR producer at the same company, Worlds, we started working on this piece, which layers the experience of Japanese Americans interned and incarcerated in World War II for the crime of having Japanese blood in their veins, with later threats in the 1979-80 era to intern Iranians for the same crime of being Iranian during the Iranian hostage crisis. But because of my experience with dealing with Starbright World, I also said, look, I want to show this piece anywhere in the world that there's electricity. I'm going to make it really simple. One PC, one projector, which means monoscopic, not stereo, and a very large screen so that it gives you an immersive feeling. A very simple joystick to navigate through the world, like the joysticks that handicapped people use on their motorized wheelchairs to drive through the real world. I'm happy to say at some point I realized this was one of the first VR artworks acquired by a US art museum. It was acquired by the San Jose Museum of Art in Silicon Valley back in 2002. And it, I have shown it all over the world. It required me to build a simulation of the Mansur internment camp, not the full camp, but enough to give you a sense of it, using a lot of archival images, headlines of newspapers, but also photographs that were taken in the camps, showing there were real people in real situations in these camps. You have to drive the narrative yourself. You have to walk around and explore. You come into this barracks, the door shuts behind you. You're trapped with the ghosts. You have to find another way out. But in order to avoid just kind of constantly hitting you over the head with negative feelings, then I alternate positive and negative spaces. So you enter this Japanese room, and it transforms around you into a paradise garden. It's the same mountains of Manzanar, but now framed with a beautiful garden. But if you go too deep into the garden, you fall back into the camp. And this motion that you do yourself, you are yourself responsible for bursting the dream, destroying the illusion. And again, when you enter the barracks, the door will close behind you. You need to find another way out. This is what we call the American Dream sequence, showing showing people immigrating from Japan, wading through the documents, the immigration documents, and then appearing in the New World. I'm going to jump on ahead. This is a parallel level later on in the same barrack structure, showing similar threats to intern Iranian Americans and really showing the parallel structure of basically blaming people as scapegoats for what's happening when their home country, their original country, then attacks the US. Again, a positive space where there's personal photographs of friends and families, but if you go too close to the images, then the walls turn transparent and you see the media images of what the media, how the media portrays you, how the outside portrays you. And again, the only way out of this situation is to flee into a fantasy cultural space, this time a Persian garden, because the landscape of Manzanar with the beautiful mountains, but the very, very dry, arid terrain, very different from the very moist landscapes of Japan, looks like paradise to Iranian Americans who are used to this high desert environment, the snow-covered mountains. But again, if you try and leave the garden, you start, in this case, the war. I'm going to move on and just give you a couple of other images from pieces I did with similar technology, Travels of Mariko Horo, where I really collide the Christian cosmology, especially as described by Dante, with Buddhist cosmology, trying to create sort of a mixed up world that is alien to both Easterners and Westerners. And it has multiple levels of heavens, multiple levels of hells. Some of the hells are landscapes inhabited by victims of wars that America has started right when I needed to start building. The first of the hells was when the US invaded Iraq for the vanity of the president of the time, and where he actually lied to the UN about having evidence of mass destruction. Third piece that I did with this technology is Virtuelle Mauer, reconstructing the wall, where we reconstructed a linear kilometer of the Berlin Wall, including neighborhoods in both East Berlin and West Berlin, and then separated by the West Wall, the East Wall, and the Death Strip in the middle. So again, you need to walk through the space as you're walking through this space in Mariko Horo took you through multiple heavens and multiple hells. In this Berlin Wall piece, you're taken alongside the wall. In the west, you can walk up to the wall. It's brightly painted with graffiti. There's a lot of tourists talking about the wall. If you're in East Germany and you try the same thing approaching the wall, then if you get too close to restricted areas that any East Berliner would immediately recognize, but, you know, dumb West Berliners just kind of like go right up to there, and what happens? They get arrested and interrogated. So again, all these three pieces, your own movements through the space are leading you through the narrative. That also gives you, it gives you the feeling of agency, but that also means it gives you the feeling of having somehow been responsible for your fate when negative things happen. These three pieces actually do work on the contemporary generation of VR headsets. It's just the first two of them, because of the restrictions of computer power in that time, I was using a lot of very flat imagery. Any figures were flat. The Virtuelle Mauer was done late enough so we could have 3D figures, and that I did port to Oculus VR glasses in 2019, and that can be shown in both a 2D projection or in the 3D stereo. I also started working in 2017 with the new type of headset with these stereo imagery, Land of Cloud. I did as a Tilt Brush, Google Tilt Brush artist in residence, where I had created this world, this again a garden where these figures sit immobile, staring at their devices, and you have to go up to each one of the figures and put your head inside of their head to really understand what they're saying. Otherwise, it's just sort of a susurration, a murmuring of voices. It turns out that the two voices, there's a male voice uttering slogans from Trump's campaign, and a female voice uttering slogans from Hillary Clinton's campaign. So this was done right after, right around the time of the and in the aftermath of the 2016 election. So in 2010, I started working with VR. Catherine, can you give me a quick time check?
We should actually be transitioning over to conversation, but go on ahead. You've got a few more slides
okay.
left.
Yeah, I'll try and buzz through some AR stuff. So I started out with AR in 2010, when out of the blue, I got an email from Mark Skorek, who'd been doing a VR in New York. And he said, hey, send me some 3D content, because the geolocative AR technology on smartphones is now good enough. We can just put our artwork inside of MoMA, and they don't know about it, and they can't stop us from doing it. Well, it turns out they did find out, but they very graciously tweeted it instead of trying to block us from coming in. And that, of course, was the best sort of publicity we could ask for. So this was my first AR piece, the Art Critic Face Matrix, my own distorted face that seemed to be screaming, AR is not art and never will be. And I'm happy that I live long enough to see that the opinion has changed about AR art. You'll hear more about that a little bit down the line. So a bunch of us were so excited by the potential of this technology, we formed a group, manifest.ar. And then the question was, well, what do we do now? How can we top an invasion of MoMA? And I said, well, I live in Europe and I go to the Venice Biennial every time it happens. So basically, I led an intervention with seven other artists from the group. And I'll just show you one of the pieces that I did, Shades of Absence, Public Voids, looking at censorship in the arts with erased figures of artists whose work, a couple of them really in the Venice Biennial, placed in the public square in front of Basilica San Marco, with inside of a golden pavilion created of words of censorship, like utterly without redeeming social value, or seditious, or pornographic, etc. So we went on to do a lot of other interventions. Rain of Gold was another call to action from Mark Skorek, where it was doing the Occupy Wall Street protests, and the New York Stock Exchange was the seat of, or the focus of a lot of those protests. So they were walled off with these barriers. So he called us to create AR works that could be viewed around there and sent around the world as memes. So I created this falling rain of golden coins. And sure enough, there were protests happening all over the world. So Warren Armstrong, another group member who's in Australia, sent some images of a friend, Holger Grahn, sent images from the protests, the Occupy Wall Street protests in Berlin. And then I wanted to show you as a contrast, a very different type of project using a very similar imagery. So again, a rain of gold coins, but I asked people to write on a whiteboard, how much do you need to be happy? And this one took it very literally. He said, oh, you know, €1 million would be just fine, thank you. But, and other people said, well, not much. And then I love this one, the gentleman with the orange background, he was really in a bad mood. And he wrote, today, no luck, heute kein Glück. And what I did in all these cases then was make a AR screenshot of them holding their sign, printed it out on a little credit card, card-sized instant printer, and gave it to them as a good luck charm. Well, it turns out when I developed the image of this guy, the coins had fallen exactly to eradicate the word no luck. So it reads today luck. So that was really, for him, the perfect good luck charm. I've done projects where I've been the advisor rather than an artist myself. Mi Querido Barrio, which Catherine mentioned, is unfortunately not running anymore because the app went out of business. But I worked with the Caribbean Cultural Center and African Diaspora Institute in East Harlem, also known as Spanish Harlem, teaching their artists to put their artworks on their streets in their community. So for instance, Olavo Rios had been a graffiti artist and had taken photographs of his work and other works. He put them back on the buildings where they used to be. And then Yasmin Hernandez, inside of the Taino Towers social housing, put up a ceremonial Taino gathering circle in the courtyard of that building. The Taino are the original native inhabitants of Puerto Rico. And they asked me to contribute a piece, but since I'm not from the community, I said, well, can you ask people to write down in their own handwriting what makes El Barrio feel like home? And then I put it up in gold with their name and their own handwriting as a tribute to the community. I've done this also in Seattle. I'm going to go through this a little bit quickly, working together with my mother, who's a master calligrapher. So looking at 18 spots around Seattle and then putting her calligraphy up at spots that meant something to us. And then again, as an advisor right now in San Jose, this is a live project where I taught then 9 people from the community to also create pieces that depict the mixed Japanese American, Chinese American, Filipino American culture and heritage and history that all happens in what's called San Jose Japantown. I started working with issues of climate change and with the natural world with a commission from the Seattle Art Museum, showing plants that are native to the area and hopefully will survive at least the immediate changes, but I mutate them in weird ways. So for instance, the bulwark kelp, instead of being on the surface of the water, are floating like helicopters way high in the sky, giving you an impression of rising water levels. And then these beautiful farewell to spring flowers, if you look close at them, they expand to sort of suck you and fill in your screen. And you see that they've got these antennas in the middle that are like sucking the rays out of your smartphone as their nourishment. And then I found about these red algae, which are triggered by the warming waters, will explode on the coast all over the world, actually, and create these toxic red tides that poison the sea creatures and are also injurious to humans. And this one I found is not only on the West Coast, but also in New York Harbor. And so here's one version that I had put in Pioneer Works a number of years back. My most recent piece with this sort of realistic natural world is running right now in Washington, D.C., in the Smithsonian Arts and Industries building, which was built, I think it was built about 125 years ago as the first national museum in the U.S. The commission was for the Smithsonian's 175th anniversary as the museum system of the US. And so I'm transforming, they asked us to try and think of something positive for the future. Imagine the future you want, not the future you fear. So I took up the concept of rewilding, of trying to turn back as much as possible of the city, of our parks, our own gardens, of planting strips, of you know, flat roofs around the city into wild nature, where we let whatever needs to grow, grow, because those environments provide more habitats for the insects that, again, are necessary to keep the whole ecosystem going. So monarch butterflies, people tend to know about. At some point, they were dying out, and then we realized that it's because their caterpillars need the milkweed. That's the only plant that they can eat, and you clear the milkweed because it's not so pretty, and we can't use it ourselves for anything. Let's get rid of it. Well, we almost killed off the monarchs, and that's true of many, many, many parts of our ecosystem. If we only let the plants that we think are pretty or that are useful to survive, the insects like the honeybee that are useful or pretty like the butterflies, will kill off vast portions of the ecosphere, and the whole system will collapse. So another way of dealing with the natural environment was this commission for the Whitney Museum. By the way, it's not officially on show, but it's simply there. If you download the Unexpected Growth app from the App Store and you're in the area of the Whitney, you can also be on the street level. You don't have to go inside. You can get this piece on your smartphone in the app. So inside the building, they had tablets that people could just walk in and pick right up and see that that we had planted a very colorful wreath there. And then there was textual information saying, downloaded the app of this name from the App Store, go out into the terrace and see what you can see. So it's a very colorful wreath, but if you look closely, you'll realize it's all made out of plastic, the same sort of plastic that we're throwing into the oceans. And actually, over the course of the day, as more and more people download the app, it slowly starts bleaching. And each individual is not responsible for a huge change in the ecosystem, but just the sheer numbers of human beings that we are in the world today altogether have an effect. So if you go on a Friday or Saturday when the exhibit is officially running, you might actually see it completely bleached out white. Obviously, right now, when people don't know it's there, you'll see it very robust. This was my first excursion into 3D printing. It's a ceramic print and turned out to be very, very brittle and fragile. I'm looking for other ways of printing without using plastics. But this is, again, one of my composite corals made out of different types of plastic waste. But they're my ideas that, you know, if you look at in the AR app associated with it, you see that there's a whole coral reef around you. Well, the white one is the one that's bleached thoroughly, fallen out of the virtual into the real world because it's dead. We've also have another piece called Evolution of Fish, where you can guide the fish around, but the more you guide them around, the more you intervene in their life cycle, the more they turn into plastic. We put this up in the Digital Graffiti Festival as large projections on the side of the building. And because it's an AR app, anyone standing in front of it becomes part of the projection, part of the artwork. And it turns out we really had people wrapping around the block, waiting their turn to become part of the artwork, which is great because then people take photographs and they spread them around and people ask, well, what's all that garbage doing there? Well, it's a, you know, it's because we're throwing all this stuff into the ocean. So that's a way of spreading the image around. If you make it playful enough so people want to engage with it, want to take photographs and want to spread it around. One version we had in a gallery here, we actually asked friends to collect the plastic that just accumulated normally in their life. And then we put it on all the walls and the surfaces of the gallery space. And this is now taken with the app running on my smartphone. So I get the additional layer of the fish over the real plastic and also over the projection that's going out of the tablet on being projected onto the walls. And you can guide them around. They'll always be sort of running in front of you a little bit like dogs do. And so they'll go and check out anything that you're looking at closely, which is kind of a nice effect. Last piece I wanted to show you, putting this all together to really create a totally immersive environment. This in an unused train station underpass in Germany, where we had six very weak and small projectors, but by pointing them at a raking angle, we could cover a lot more of the wall. And then we lined the tunnel with plastic that people had donated to us, just the plastic that accumulated in their daily lives, to give you the feeling of what it would be like to have to spend your entire life surrounded with plastic, as we are doing to the ocean denizens. And here's a version that we were able to show for 3 weeks in a new cultural center in Milan, Italy. They have and what they call the immersive room, 20 meter long walls. This is the same size as the terrace at the Whitney, but it's 15 projectors making for a seamless, 50 meter projection. And again, with tablets placed so that people can project themselves into being part of the installation. We got about like 40 articles, all in Italian. People were taking photographs and making TikTok dance versions and posting them. And you know, the piece is called Enter the Plasticine. So again, every time it's being reposted and talked about, we're spreading around the consciousness of, you know, don't turn our artwork into reality. We want it to stay in the realm of fantasy. Okay, that's it. I'll just stop the share.
Oh, thank you so much, Tomiko. This is, I'm familiar with your work, but it's also just so exciting to see the span of work across this period of time that you've been working in, you know, sort of mixed reality platforms, and just the breadth and the range of themes that your work tackles. It's super impressive. So thank you for sharing.
Thank you. And you know, VR, it took me 5 years to make each of those pieces because there's so much research and building. And AR, then, you know, I think the fastest I've ever done a new piece is like 2 hours. I really love that about AR, is that you can do things really quickly that are very poignant because you're using the environment as your stage. Your artwork is not just those images on the smartphone. It's also the environment you're standing in and the person's movement through space as they're looking at this installation.
Yeah, very much so. So out there, on the internet, we have Tomiko here. We have a period where we have opportunity for discussion and question and answer. So I want to turn that opportunity to ask questions over to you all. Please go ahead and either raise your hand or feel free to unmute yourself and ask your question if you're so inclined.
Yes. Hi, can you hear me?
Oh, yes, we do. Hi. Okay, Nell. We heard you before. Would you like to ask your question, Nell? I think Richard's working on the echo.
Hi. Can you talk a little about your research process and your initial idea of building?
Right. It's different from every piece, of course, but especially when the site is clear, then I look at the site, potentially the history of the site, certainly sort of the problematics of the site. So, you know, with the Whitney piece, I could have also done a huge deep dive into the history of the piece, as Catherine was talking about you know, the many other Native American layers of it. But we specifically needed to have an algorithmic portion. So P and I came very quickly on the idea of doing a coral reef that would help visualize a rising water level that had reached the sixth floor terrace and engulfed it. So basically that's what focused that piece with the, you know, with something like the Manzanar internment camp. There was a lot of historical research in the National Archives and a lot of discussions with Zara, where, you know, I was sort of, you know, talking to her about Japanese culture and also the Japanese American experience. She, in her turn, was, you know, talking about Persian Iranian culture and how, you know, how this sort of various political problematics has had affected Iranian Americans. So there was a you know, really a 5-year process of learning from each other and then trying to develop a structure that would show parallels and differences. So for each project, it's very different, you know, at some point I realized that my VR stuff tends to be what I would call site-specific VR, so that the, you know, the environment is that I'm creating is really part of the content of the artwork. It's definitely not neutral. So you know, depending on how deep things go, there can be a lot of research. For instance, the Gardens of the Anthropocene, then I was also talking to local climate scientists, and they were bringing me up to speed on what was happening with climate change. Richard says, contrast between artificial and virtual in the natural world, using virtual fish to talk about the real endangered nature, for example. And that has a very specific reason. You know, I had been, Sash P and I had been in Southeast Asia often for a number of years. And we were on one a sailing trip where they took us to a completely deserted island, no one living there. It was strewn with plastic. And that was the first time that I really had a personal encounter with the problem of plastic garbage all over the world. And you know, we learned then through research we found that there was some piece of plastic garbage from Germany. There was a lot that was from American sources, even though we were in Southeast Asia. So there's a lot of places in the world we realized where they're dealing on a daily basis with a lot of garbage washing up, but they clean the beaches before the resort guests go out onto the beach, so they don't see it. At that point, people were saying, well, Southeast Asia has the biggest problem because they don't have high standards, whereas here in the West, in the US and in Europe, we have high standards of cleanliness, and therefore we don't have garbage on our beaches. And then we found out that what's happening is that the stuff we call recycling is all being sent off to Southeast Asia. And yeah, they don't have high standards there, but that's our garbage also being put into the ocean. So, you know, you can't transport vast numbers of your audience to some beach in Southeast Asia. So I said, let's transport the garbage into their environment, whether it's a, you know, white cube gallery or whether it's an amazing projection system. Let's bring through virtual means, bring that environment to the people who might not go and visit that sort of environment themselves. So that's really a very specific use of why I'm using the virtual to confront people with real, because it gives them a more lived experience, an immersive experience that gives them more of an emotional connection to that issue.
There was a question above Richard's from Alex Lee, and the question was, a lovely presentation, curious about AR smartphone challenges, various smartphone devices and optimization issues, some pitfalls you've encountered. So it looks like a question about the technology, phones, and the challenges of working with various different devices.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of different levels of challenges. One point is that because I started working with virtual reality when, you know, you could only do 640 by 480 images and very few textures and very few polygons, I've been working essentially since 1994 in a very low poly, low resolution environment. And so when I switched over to AR, then it was it was the same thing. You know, I could only do very small pieces in terms of you know, size and complexity. So think of it as writing a haiku or a poem instead of writing a novel. And it really is that sort of difference, you know. And is a novel more impactful than a poem? Maybe, but maybe not. So I was very used to, you know, having to think of maybe, so to speak, more sort of poetic, simplified in terms of their technological complexity means of getting a message across or creating a mood. And then in terms of the technology, in terms of the hardware, you know, again, you have to move with the time. So initially, I'm still mostly using Geolocative because I've learned how to work with it. Almost no one else does because it's difficult. It doesn't stay in the same place. But I do these 360 degree installations where everything's floating around anyway. So it works out very well. And that enables me to do much more larger and complex installations now than people who are sitting there making very complicated and high poly 3D objects, and they only end up having like one single object in their AR piece. So you know, you have to really look at the technology, what it can do, and then go for maximum effect with, you know, minimum technological impact, and deal with the fact that, you know, every 3 years the technology is changing, so you have to be able to stay on it and migrate it. And but that also means that every 3 years or so you're able to do things that you weren't able to do before. So it has pluses and minuses, but it's very much like surfing a wave and trying to make sure that you don't wipe out.
We have another question. It's also from Nell here. And this is a really interesting one. So how did you move from mechanical work, like doing all the wiring for the connection machine, to virtual? Why did you switch? And do you have a preference?
Yeah, you know, I have always thought very three-dimensionally when I was a kid and couldn't afford to go horseback riding. I collected 3D model, plastic model sculptures, and I scratched off their paint and repainted them in different ways and built tack for them, built my own saddles and bridles. So I've always been a very three-dimensional person, but also a very visual person. And at some point, as a mechanical engineer, sort of I realized I wanted a much more rich visual environment. And then working on the connection machine, you know, I had 2 years where they literally told me the machine's going to cost $3 to $5 million. Don't worry about how much the package costs. Just make sure that when people see it, they are bowled over. Because, you know, we're a young company, we're a young startup, we're, you know, the chief scientist is 26 years old. We're bringing people in and saying, you've never seen a machine like this in your life. And for only $3 to $5 million, here's the check, it can be yours, you know. And if they walk in and say, oh my God, it looks exactly like the refrigerator I just bought, then you've lost, you know. So it had to be spectacular. And I personally, as the designer, wanted it to communicate what made it so different from any other machine you could have bought for the same amount of money. So after those 2 years, when they said, okay, now it's time to decide, you know, what size screws do you need and how long is each cable? I said, you know what, I'm going to go to art school. I've had too much fun dealing with this, you know, the cultural aspects. What does AI mean to us? What could it become? How has it been represented in film, in literature? And that's what I want to do for the rest of my life. And I think that's what artists do. So it really was sort of a hunger that I have for visual imagery that eventually sort of drove me from the sort of tangible 3D into first imagery, doing video, and then actually fairly early on into doing VR, where again you're dealing with space, you're dealing with objects, but you're also able to create whatever environment you want. So very, very visual art. So for me, it really is a continuum, and you know, whether it's virtual or real is not so important.
That's excellent. We have what this is going to be. Turns out this is going to be probably our last question before we run out of time. But Richard asks, what advice do you have for students about to graduate inspired by such a long and thriving career you have?
Document your projects. You know, you might think they're really silly right now, even your school projects. But for one thing, if you document them, then in 5 to 10 years, you can look back and say, oh my God, you know, look at how I've changed. Sometimes you look back, like I look back on my sketchbooks and say, oh my God, I used to be able to draw so well. I wonder if I'd be able to get back there. But, you know, I was the only person collecting documentation on the connection machine and putting it on the website and really putting a lot of energy in my life into it. And 30 years later, it paid off. If I hadn't done that, then, you know, no one would have been interested in putting it in MoMA at all. And then it turns out that, you know, if you live long enough so that, you know, media art has only been really kind of accepted as art for the last, I'd say, 5 years or so, maybe 7. 10 is stretching it. So, you know, all of us who have been working, you know, like Catherine and Jonah and Richard, all of us who have been working in it for a long time, you know, if we hadn't documented our projects, they would have gone, they would have been disappeared because no one was interested in them at that point. So you don't know how things will change later on in your life. But, you know, document your projects well when you make them. If they don't work then in three years or longer, you still have the ideas and you can start seeing an arc. And one thing about getting old, frankly, is that's really wonderful, is being able to see how these arcs go throughout history. I've seen the arc of AI technology being, you know, incredibly exciting and hyped, and then it dies out, and everyone for decades is saying AI is a total fiction. It'll never work. It's a dead end. Forget it. And then what happens? All of a sudden, you know, all those researchers have been working on it, and, you know, behind the scenes, And all of a sudden it does work. And then people say, oh, it's going to change the world. And the same thing happened with VR technology, you know? So it goes through these cycles, and at some point you get this perspective of like, nothing is ever really lost. You know, keep on, if something's important to you, keep on working on it. I've seen, you know, friends of mine who were figurative painters went through the 60s and the 70s, where if they painted figuratively and showed it to someone else, they were told, you have no clue what art's about. Figurative art is so dead. You are obviously not a real artist. What happens in the 80s? All of a sudden, figurative is back, you know? So it's all fashion. It's all hype. Do what you really want to do, hold on to your stuff, document it. And, you know, if you're lucky, you won't have to wait 30 years like I did before it starts becoming interesting to other people.
But I mean, we are all so much better for the fact that you continued to work, you know, along these trajectories, because there's a beautiful career history there. And honestly, I think, you know, for me, Farewell to Manzanar was a very influential work, primarily. And I've told you this before, because for me at the time in 2000, there really wasn't a lot of work out there that dealt with the lived experience of people with color, you know, and really looking at issues deeply embedded with technology, but actually concerned with more than just technology. A lot of the work from that era is very self-referential.
Yeah.
And very fixated on the technology itself rather than the issues upon which technology has impact. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, that work was a very meaningful thing for me to encounter in that time period. And I very much appreciate that. We have one last question, but we actually are out of time. Benny, my sincerest apologies. We have to go ahead and close this event. So I want to say thank you so much, Tomiko, for joining us and for sharing your work with us. It's really fantastic. We want to go ahead and acknowledge the students of the Cloud Salon class, Nell, Io, Anna, Hannah, Joshua, Trisha, and Zane, our organizer, Richard Tay, who's...
Thank you, Richard. You know,
thank you. And support from the program from Kyle Lee, Colleen Macklin, Melanie Crean. Thank you all. And just so you all know, next week, we will have Kyle McDonald joining us as a part of this fantastic series. So thank you so much, everyone, for coming. Thank you so much, Tomiko, for sharing your work. Thank you, everybody who's been involved in making Cloud Salon happen. And I hope you all have a wonderful Tuesday.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, bye, everybody.
Bye.
Thanks so much. Thank you.
Thank you.